Sarah said something as we were speaking that really, really resonated with me and something that I hadn't really thought about myself before. But when I was growing up, I also was an actor. I performed constantly. And I felt more in touch with myself and more at home with myself when I was performing than I did when I was not performing. I was always so grounded. I felt my feet on the floor when I was performing. And I think that the reason for that might be because I was performing all the time. I was constantly performing. And that was a space that it was allowed or perhaps expected of me. Because when I was 7, I was diagnosed with something called Lyme disease, which I'm sure that many of you have heard of. And in the town when I was growing up, everybody had heard of Lyme disease. Everybody knew somebody who had Lyme disease. Everybody knew what Lyme disease was. But they thought of Lyme disease in this very small, narrow way. They thought of Lyme disease as something that you get bit by a tick, you take some medicine, you get better. And when you didn't get better, we didn't quite understand what that was. It wasn't the Lyme disease that fit into the definition that everybody had set out and that everybody was so aware of in my town and thought of all the time in my town. And what happened to me is I didn't get better for years. I was first diagnosed when I was 7 years old in 1998. And as I started to go through puberty, I had constant symptoms. I was in constant pain. I had a lot of exhaustion, a lot of joint pain, things like that. And I was lucky enough to find a doctor, which many people are not lucky enough to do, who would treat me very aggressively. So I was on antibiotic therapy for years. I had started high school with a PICC line in my arm. And I, in many ways, my experience with Lyme as I was growing up and in the beginning of high school was visible because I was had track marks that were a PICC line or something like that, but it was something that no one talked about. We didn't even talk about it in my family. I didn't talk about it with my close friends. I didn't talk about it with my siblings. I barely talked about it with my parents, even though my father also was suffering from Lyme. And this all sort of came to a head in my senior year of high school. Up until that year, my symptoms were manageable. I was in treatment and missing lots of school, but it was mostly pain, headaches, exhaustion, things like that. Nothing that was debilitating, truly. My senior year of high school, my parents were going to move to Boston, and I was about to be a senior. I was so involved in the arts community at school, and I really, really wanted to stay to finish off my senior year. So we decided that I was going to stay in my house, which was now empty. My family moved up to Massachusetts, and in the first about 6 weeks after they moved, and really in the weeks leading up to it, I suddenly lost my ability to speak. The exhaustion became so crippling that I almost could not get out of bed most days. I was sleeping almost 20 hours a day. In the month of August, I was in 6 car accidents. Thankfully, none of them were too debilitating, but 6 car accidents because I was losing my sort of ability to control that machinery. I was struggling to speak, I was struggling to read, I was getting lost in places that I had been for 8 years of my life. I was forgetting phone calls with my mom. I would call her, hang up the phone, and call her back and tell her the same thing. I was experiencing neurological symptoms that up until that point, I had no association with Lyme. And we were lucky enough to have just moved to Boston, or my family had, which is one of the medical epicenters of the world, and got a meeting with the head of pediatrics at one of the biggest hospitals. And we were told in the first meeting, in the first hour, before he even spoke to me, that it was physically impossible that I was suffering from Lyme or any other tick-borne infection, and that I was actually having a mental breakdown in response to my parents' move, that I was regressing to the point of infancy, and that's why I couldn't speak or drive a car or read a book, because I was regressing back to the place that I needed my parents to take care of me. And the feeling of that, of sitting across the room with someone who was so much smarter and knows so much more than me, my first instinct was not to say, no, you're wrong. My first instinct was to say, maybe I'm wrong. Maybe I've been wrong this whole time. And the reason why I haven't been fitting into that box of what Lyme disease is because it's all made up. And I completely lost faith in myself and in my confidence, my relationship with my body and my relationship with health, that I truly stopped talking about it. I went back to school my senior year after I was finally able to get healthy and pretended as if it had never happened. When I went to college, I actively sort of kept things from people who are now some of the closest people to me in my life, because I was so scared that if I told people really what had happened, that they wouldn't believe me, that they would tell me that I was crazy. And it wasn't until my senior when at Bard College you write a senior project, and I was studying writing. And I was sort of reflecting back on what I could write about myself. Is there anything that's interesting enough about me that I could write about? And mine seemed to be the only thing that I had. But I couldn't put pen to paper about what it was that I had gone through. I was so terrified to write down my experience because I was scared even I wouldn't believe it anymore at this point. And so what I did instead was I reached out to people in the community, and Lyme is pretty endemic in Dutchess County in upstate New York. And I found that I was not alone, that almost every person who I talked to, and there were so many people who wanted to talk to me, had been through exactly what I had been through. They had been told that it was in their head, or they had been told that they were just crazy. And it was more and more and more with women specifically who had been told this. And so I wrote my senior thesis about my experiences as a number of other Lyme patients from around the world. And it was called Suffering the Silence, Chronic Lyme Disease and Age of Denial. And I got lucky enough to have it picked up by a publisher, North Atlantic Books, and it was published in September of last year. And the community that I have found and has renewed a sense of security in myself and my the way that I perceive my body and the way that I perceive the world is that I am immensely, immensely grateful for. And it also opened this whole new chapter in my life that I'll let Erica sort of pick up the narrative from here. But it has opened this whole new chapter in my life that has become what Suffering the Silence is today, and I couldn't feel luckier to be a part of it, and I'm so grateful to get to share that story with all of you.